As you probably know, I am the technology transfer coordinator of Neuromat. I think it's better. Yeah. Okay. So Neuromat is a research, innovation, and dissemination center. So one of our key aspects is innovation. So I'll just talk briefly about our point of view on innovation. So as I say there, our mission is to create a new conceptual framework to approach the brain and develop innovation, innovative tools and applications based on it. So based on our new developments, which is different from applying existing tools to biology or to neuroscience. So we've been approached by people from the biology asking us to teach them how to use a software that they have there, but they don't know how to handle it or to prepare a nice interface for a software that they already have, which implements things like Fourier transforms or things that are already known for centuries. That's not our mission. Of course, that's important for neurobiologists to learn how to use the tools, the existing tools, but our mission is to create new tools based on our new research, our innovative research. Okay, so it's important that this is stressed. And our innovations should be strongly based on theoretical developments made by our research team. That's our mission. Just to make sure, our research goal, or the main research goal, is to explain complex neuroscientific phenomena with focus on plasticity mechanisms, underlying learning, memory, neural rehabilitation, and adaptive rewiring. That's why one of the major discussions for this workshop. Regarding innovation activities, our main innovation activities can be divided into two fronts: therapeutic initiatives, which will be discussed this morning. Oops. Yeah. And computational tools, which will be discussed, I believe, in the afternoon. No? Regarding the therapeutic initiatives, they are focused on neural rehabilitation and diagnosis. So now Siddharth will talk about psychosis and psychiatric illnesses. And in the rest of the day, people will be talking about plasticity in brachial plexus avulsion and plasticity in Parkinson's disease. So these are our three main issues now currently in the therapeutic aspect of innovation. Regarding the computational tools, we will be discussing this today and somewhat tomorrow as well. Tomorrow, yeah. So they're focused on the development of free and open source software. And we'll be hearing a lot about the goalkeeper game and the neuroscience experiments system, NESS, and also the Neuromat database of neuroscientific data. So I think that's all for me this morning. I'll leave you now with Siddharth Ribeiro from the Brain Institute in Natal. He's one of distinguished Neuromat partners or members. So he'll talk about the first item that I pointed to you regarding therapeutic applications. Okay? So Siddharth, it's up to you now.
Hello, thanks, Roque. Good morning, everybody. Thanks, the organizers, Roque, Antonio, Magda, and hello to all the friends there, the colleagues. So the topic I brought to discuss with you has to do with research performed in my laboratory as well as in the laboratory of Professor Mauro Coppelli from the Federal University of Pernambuco. All of the stuff I'm going to show today, published as well as unpublished data, comes from the work of two students, mostly Natalia Mota Bezerra Mota, PhD students, and also Silvia Pinheiro, master's degree students. So the notion that you can analyze words spoken by a patient or any person regarding problems or diseases, the notion that you can use words to map the structure of the mind of the person in hopefully with some therapeutic goal is something that started to become part of science with the contribution of Sigmund Freud. Until Freud, most diseases of thought were basically diseases waiting for an organic discovery to happen. People were looking for some sort of brain lesion that could explain psychiatric diseases. And then starting with Charcot and then Breuer and Freud, a new notion arose in which people started to believe that there were different kinds of disease that were not so raw, so crude, that did not depend on brain lesions, but actually depended on very subtle perturbations that could not possibly be mapped certainly couldn't be mapped with the techniques that existed then, but could be indirectly mapped by listening to a session of free conversation with the patient himself or herself. This notion of free association, when the person lays down in a couch and then mind wanders, this is something that really became important with psychoanalysis, with the Freudian contribution. And even though people have mocked this technique for many decades, now it's becoming very clear. There was a recent major review about the therapeutic of psychosis, and it's very clear that a lot of drugs with no talking therapy is bad, but a little bit of a low dose of psychiatric drugs with a lot of talking to a good professional helps a lot. So this notion that you can get cured by talking and exploring your own mind is central to psychoanalysis, and it's central to what we're going to talk today. In particular, Freud noted the powerful content of dreams. He said, when people are reporting their dreams, we sort of get to the core of the issues that are related to their problems. He coined this famous, or I should say infamous phrase, the dreams of the royal road to the unconscious, to mean that, to say that there was something particularly informative in dreams. And we're going to revisit this notion in the coming slides. At the turn of the 19th century, Freud was sort of isolated from the rest of psychiatry, but he was in contact with the other founding fathers of psychiatry, in particular Kraepelin and Bleuler. And they disagreed on many things, but they agreed on some things. They had very strong agreements about the relationship between dreaming and psychosis. They believed that psychosis was some sort of dreaming awake. And this was very influential until pretty much the 50s. In particular, they noticed that when people were undergoing a psychotic attack, they would get their thoughts very disorganized and very incoherent with very crazy associations, so to speak. And this is something they would also observe when people reported dreams. So both schizophrenia and bipolar disorder, which are diseases linked to psychosis, diseases that can express psychosis, are diseases in which language symptoms are very clear. So thought disorganization as a general symptom, but this can be expressed as flight of thought, so the person just moves from one topic to another without connection.
Excuse me, Siddhartha, just yes. A moment. We're not seeing your slides. I don't know if you're aiming at presenting them to us. We see the set of all slides, but not each one individually.
From the beginning?
Yeah, from the beginning, yeah.
How about now?
Yeah.
How about now?
No, yeah, not yet.
Well, I was working with, when I tested with Magadan. I don't know.
Yeah, you should. Slideshow, no?
Well, I'm putting in slideshow, and I'm seeing the slide in my screen here, just like I tested with her.
I think we'll have to adjust
here. Você selecionou algum slide?
Sim, mas eu estou, estou em modo de apresentação, a tela toda tomada pelo slide aqui.
Ué.
Exatamente como a gente fez antes. Será que vocês estão olhando a apresentação que eu mandei?
Não, a gente está vendo a apresentação com todos os slides, sabe?
Eu vou sair, tá certo? Eu vou sair.
Tá.
E vou entrar de novo. Vamos lá. Fui. Nada?
É, a tela não está mudando.
É a lei de Murphy, né? Porque a gente acabou de testar. A gente já acabou de testar. Deixa eu ver uma outra questão. Será que se faz diferença que hora que eu compartilho?
É, talvez tentar colocar o compartilhamento de novo, então.
Isso. Eu vou primeiro colocar... Tá, vamos aqui. Compartilhar ecrã. Foi.
Aí voltou com todos os slides.
Agora deveria entrar. Entrou?
Não.
Não? Que maravilha. Que tal se você... A gente acabou de testar isso, certo?
Sim.
Meu Deus. É, você tem a minha apresentação aí. Você podia passar primeiro slide, segundo slide.
Sim. Sim.
Siddhartha, bom dia. Quem fala é o Ricardo. Eu sou o técnico aqui.
Ricardo.
É, tudo bem?
Tudo bom?
Eu acho que talvez seja alguma opção, sugestão, não sei, alguma opção de compartilhamento que não está permitindo que você mostre a tela cheia, quando você faz a tela cheia. Então, duas opções. Ou não sei se dá tempo agora de explorar isso, ou então tentar não deixar no modo apresentação. Se você só maximizar um slide, por exemplo, entendeu? Como se você fosse editar,
entendi.
E aí ele vai, teoricamente, eu acho que ele vai mostrar. Eu acho que quando você põe a apresentação, que ele toma a tela toda, eu acho que não está deixando compartilhar por algum motivo. Vê se você consegue abrir um slide individual, assim. É, mais ou menos assim. Aí agora a gente está vendo, só que pequeno, né? Que eu acho que... Isso, pronto. Agora pelo menos... está cortando. Porque existe... Talvez no Skype, a hora que você escolhe para compartilhar, deve estar escolhendo para compartilhar só uma coisa.
Mas sabe o que é mais esquisito? É que há menos de 10 minutos eu testei com a Nádia.
Eu estava aqui, a gente estava vendo, sim.
Cara, será que eu tenho que dar um... É que se eu mandar se eu mandar ele...
É porque você escolhe o que você vai compartilhar. Talvez esteja escolhendo só o aplicativo, e aí ele não deixa tomar a tela toda. Ou então, tem que ver algum desses modos de compartilhamento, sabe, do Skype.
Tive uma ideia aqui.
Peraí, deixa eu...
Diminui só um pouquinho o slide, Siddhartha, que está cortando em cima. Acho que assim está legal, né? Está legal.
Dá para fazer?
Agora dá,
Então tá. O que eu mostrei antes foi basicamente... Ai, meu Deus, peraí. O que eu mostrei antes para vocês foi basicamente o divã do Freud. What I was showing before was that this method of letting people talk freely was developed by Freud and associates, and it became very influential, although sort of separate from science. And even though Freud disagreed a lot with other psychiatrists of his time, they agreed that dreams were very important, and that during dreams, people expressed thought that was disorganized like in psychosis. And people would show flights of thoughts, changing the discourse in a sort of incoherent manner, alogia, in which they actually don't talk a lot, don't express their thoughts, logorrhea, when they talk a lot, and word salad, which is actually a clinical term. It's a symptom when people seem to be dropping words in a random manner. So if we are talking about thought disorganization, if we're talking about something that seems to be not well structured, then graph analysis seems to be a natural choice of tool because graphs are basically the structure of networks. And they can be understood and they can be quantified and they can generate parameters that may be useful for differential diagnosis. When I say differential diagnosis, I'm talking about discerning whether a psychotic patient is schizophrenic or has schizophrenia, or has bipolar disorder, or something else, which you know could happen. So what are the numbers? What are the things that can be measured in a graph? I'm probably preaching to the converted. Most of you are mathematicians. But for those that are not, so if you're talking about a directed graph, like a discourse of a person in which each word is a node, is one of those little red circles there. Then the edges are just the sequence of consecutive words. They show how you connect from one word to the next word and then to the next word. So in this case, it's a directed graph. And you can compute a variety of things here, which are either local numbers, like you know, what is the degree of a particular node, or the average total degree. Or you can measure recurrences, local recurrences, like parallel edges or repeated edges. Or you can measure what you know, something like a long-range recurrence or measures of connectedness, like the largest connected component or the largest strongly connected component. And then measures of graph size, like diameter, and so on. We, in the past few years, developed some code, some free software to transform text into graphs and then extract those numbers. This is available for any person in our website, which I show here. It's a software called Speech Graphs, and it was registered here at the Federal University of Rio Grande do Norte in collaboration with Pernambuco. Using this software, we started to investigate dream and waking reports of patients with schizophrenia, bipolar disorder, or matched controls. And we found that the dream reports can be very informative of the psychiatric state, while the waking reports apparently not. As you can see in the bottom panel here, when people are talking about waking activities, they tend to be very linear or chronological. So, for example, if you take the control, it's just a sequence of nodes with no loops. And it's like a person saying, you know, I woke up in the morning, I took a bus, I went to USP, and then I was watching a talk, and then another seminar, and then I had lunch, and then another talk, and another talk. And then we had this marvelous dinner that Hockey was announcing. A bipolar disorder patient or a schizophrenic patient may give you a little bit of recurrence, may give you a little bit of as you can see here, can you see the cursor? Can you see the cursor moving over the data? Are you guys there? Okay. So you see that it's still sort of linear. This is very different from what you get when you analyze dream reports, okay? So you can see the schizophrenic tends to be very laconic with alogia, the control in the middle, and the bipolar, you know, quite the opposite, with a lot of nodes, a lot of recurrences. We wanted to control for verbosity differences because you can always have a person that has bipolar disorder typically should be a talkative person, but this, maybe that particular patient is not very talkative. And maybe a schizophrenic patient that should be less talkative happens to be more talkative. How do you control for individual differences? So one way in which you can go about this is to use a moving window. So what we did was to compute graphs for every 30 words. So compute a graph, extract the numbers, then move the window with 50% overlap, so 15 words, and then compute it again and again and again. We did it with 10 words, 30, 100, you know. 30 seems to be a good compromise because patients don't tend to give you much more than that. When we do that, we find that the different groups, the schizophrenic, the bipolar, and the control, which are shown here in dark gray, light gray, and white, show significant differences in graph attributes for a variety of them, like LSC, LCC, edges, so all connectivity-related attributes. And some of those differences tend to occur only for dream and some also for waking reports. So you seem to be able to differentiate those groups based on the differences in graph attributes. Now, we use that to then correlate with symptoms. So is that at all related to the symptoms? What you see here in the x-axis, the different symptoms, the different questions in the total scores, then the positive subscale. Positive here means positive symptoms, basically hallucinations and delirium. Then the negative subscale, then the general subscale. This is all in one questionnaire, one clinical questionnaire called PANSS. Then there's another one called BPRS, and then again, several questions here, okay? And what we found is that edges, all in the y-axis, all the graph attributes, we found that edges, LCC, and LSC were negatively correlated and significantly correlated with several symptoms that tend to be negative, that tend to be related to the part of the of psychosis that does not show itself. You know, the positive symptoms are very clear. People say, well, I'm hearing voices, you know, I'm typically it's in the auditory domain, but people can also see things or have impressions or paranoia. While the negative subscale is more the person is not talking, you're not even sure the person is hallucinating at all, but the person seems to be very disturbed, and this has to do with thought disorganization. Apparent, and these symptoms are hard to measure, and apparently the graph attributes correlate well with them. This is more, you have more significant correlations for dream reports than for waking reports, only two here. We then decided to check whether it was really true that the dream reports are so particularly informative. So we got a different sample of subjects. In this case, it was subjects undergoing their first psychotic episodes, with ages in average around 15 years old, so very young subjects coming for treatment for the first time, medicated very recently. And then we also got 21 well-matched controls, and we followed them for 6 months, and at the end of the 6 months, they were diagnosed as either schizophrenic or bipolar. In the first interview, 6 months before the diagnosis, we collected dream reports. We recorded reports that they gave in response to a negative image. So just see a negative image that is validated worldwide and then say, you know, tell a story about it. Like you see a car crash and you tell a little story about the car crash. Then a positive image, you see a beautiful baby and you say some little story about the baby. Then a neutral image, telephone, a car. Then yesterday memory, so just tell me how was your day yesterday. Or tell me your oldest memory. And what we were trying to cover was different dimensions of memories, you know, the recency and as well as the value, the effective the valence. And we said maybe dreams are informative because they're just a vague memory and maybe a very old memory does the same trick. Maybe dreams are informative because they tend to be have some negative components and have more anxiety components. This is shown in psychology. So maybe a negative image will do. We were probing in the hopes of finding something that was as good as dreams. And then we used the data, we extracted the graphs, we calculated the attributes, and we used the data as inputs to a binary classifier to find schizophrenic patients as opposed to anything else. And what we found is that dream reports were indeed the most informative. As you can see here, the area under the receiving operating characteristic curve, which is a good measure of classification quality, is much higher for dream than for the other ones, then followed by the negative image, then the positive image, and then near chance, the other ones, the neutral image, the yesterday, and the oldest. When we computed accuracy, we seem to have the same sort of ranking. This is a paper that is now submitted, recently submitted, but it's already available in the bioarchives. I should have put here the connection, but if you Google our names, you'll find it. It's a paper that is basically trying to measure word salads. How did we go about that? What we did was to get each graph of each patient and shuffle it 1,000 times, keeping the nodes and shuffling the edges. So basically shuffling the words around to get the numbers for random distributions, for graphs with random distributions of edges. What we found is that schizophrenic patients tend to have their own values, their own real values, well within the distribution of values for random graphs. While in the case of bipolars, they start to go to the right, get away from the distribution, from the center of the distribution. And in the controls, they really get away, you know, far away from the distribution. When we look at the group data, this is what we see. 64% of the schizophrenic patients that we assessed were within two standard deviations from the distribution of random graphs, while only 30% of the bipolars did that, and only 5% of the controls. So it seems like the symptom word salad that exists in the literature for over 100 years can actually be measured, and we can give a precise number to it by following this simple procedure. How much time do I still have? Half an hour? Hello, is it?
Hello, sorry, yeah, you have half an hour, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay, great. So we decided to investigate how do these graph attributes evolve during development in healthy subjects as well as in psychotic subjects. For that, we sampled 200 patients as well as controls from ages 2 to 58. So we got children during alphabetization, we got adolescents, we got young adults, and then we got mature adults. What you see here in individual cases is when you analyze healthy subjects in the child, about 7 years old, in this particular case, 7 years old, this particular graph has 16 nodes, 8 repeated edges, so a lot of local recurrences, a lot of back and forth between words, and the largest strongly connected component, which is the largest component in which all nodes are mutually accessible, is only 9. It's what's circled here in blue. In an adult, we see more nodes, so we say that the lexical diversity increased. There are more different words per window, per 30-word window. Only 1 repeated edge, so very little repetition. And a much larger LSC that is actually the same size of the total number of nodes. So all the nodes are within this component. So the graph is the same as the component. And you see how different it is from the child. The child, so there was an increase in the number of different words used, a decrease in the repetitions, the local repetitions, and an increase in the range of the largest connected components. In psychotic subjects, we don't see this maturation. The child psychotic subject begins with a graph that has many more nodes than the nodes that are contained within the connected components, with a lot of repetitions, a lot of, you know, a large number of repeated edges. And then in the adult, you know, the repetitions decreased. There was not a clear increase, no increase in the number of nodes, and a modest increase in the LSC. So basically, a lot of the graph is still out of the LSC. So this is the contrast that we see in individual cases, and then we quantify that. You see here is a plot of 4 graph attributes, nodes representing lexical diversity, repeated edges representing short-range recurrence, the LSC representing long-range recurrence, and the average shortest path representing graph size. What you see here is that for nodes, nodes increase sharply within the first year of education. Here I'm not plotting age, but years of education, because we found that this is more, when you do a multiple linear correlations, you see that this is more informative. And you see here that the number of nodes increases very dramatically in, you know, when children are going through the first years of education, and they reach a plateau very soon, okay? And this is not seen in the psychotic patients. In the psychotic patients, it's basically flat, okay? So it seems like lexical diversity increases very early on. Of course, the content is different. If you ask a 7-year-old about, you know, what words will come out, you know, it's going to be Pokemon, and it's going to be ice cream. And you ask an adult, the words are going to be different. But the diversity of words is already at a plateau, you know, in fundamental school. When we look at short-range recurrence, we see sort of the opposite pattern. You know, the very young children in first grade are doing a lot of recurrences, a short-range recurrences, and that drops exponentially and reaches a minimum very early on. While in psychotic patients, you don't see that. If anything, you see an increase. It's not a significant correlation in any event. In the case of long-range recurrences, LSCs, we see something similar to what we saw with lexical diversity, except that it's much slower. So the characteristic time here is going to be around 12, 13 years old for this curve to begin the saturation. And it's very clear that it keeps growing, you know, through adolescence. While you don't see such a strong relationship in the case of the psychotic patients, and it's not a significant correlation. In the case of graph size, average shortest path, we see something very similar to what we saw with LSC. So a maturation pattern that goes into high school and non-significant patterns for psychotic patients. At this point, we said, can we measure word salad in this data as well? So what we did was to compute a normalized value for graph attributes in which the value of the attribute, the, in this case repeated edge, was divided by the value obtained in the random, for the random graphs. And so if it's one, it means that it's really, really close to random or random. What you see here is that if you get control children, healthy children below 12 years of education, you have a wide distribution and very high values that really drop after 12 years of education and come to what you should find randomly. So what this is saying is that children do more repetitions than what you would get randomly, and that this then collapses to the random values. In the case of psychotic patients, you don't see a significant difference between the two groups of less than 12 years of education and more than 12 years of education. A similar thing is seen for LSC. So you see here the LSC has values that are closer, many values that are closer to random values for the control healthy population below 12 years of education. And with education, they seem to go up, get away from the random distribution. So this is what you could call a mature pattern. In the psychotic patients, you don't see a significant difference, which means they don't really get away, significantly away from the immature pattern. And you see a similar thing for average shortest path, a distribution that becomes away from the random in the case of healthy controls, and it doesn't in the case of psychotic patients. So at that time, we started to be intrigued with a question that may seem crazy to you, may seem off the wall to you, but you'll see what sort of data we got. And these were the three questions that we started to dominate our discussion. Could psychosis represent the trace of the immature human mind also at the historical level? If we did a similar analysis on historical texts, should we get something similar to psychosis? Could early literature be structurally similar to psychotic language? And do graph attributes change over time as civilizations mature, like they change as individuals mature? You may say, well, this is totally off the wall. Where did they come with these ideas from? And these ideas actually come from the Freudian tradition. On one hand, from Melanie Klein, who in the 30s and 40s, studying children, said that she saw a lot of similarities between psychosis, psychotic speech, and childish speech. Children often confabulate. Children typically have imaginary friends. And this is so much so that below 7 years of age, you cannot even attempt to diagnose psychosis in children by the manuals. So this is an observation coming from psychoanalysis that percolated through psychiatry, that children and psychotic patients talk alike. So this is one source of the idea. The other source of the idea is the work of Julian James, a behavioral psychologist with a lot of Freudian influence, that published a seminal book in 76 called The Origin of Consciousness and the Breakdown of the Bicameral Mind. In this book, it's a long book, I cannot summarize it here, but he basically proposes that until the Troy War, until about 1200 before Christ, men were normally psychotic, that the normal state of people was psychosis, and that the breakdown of the psychotic mind gave origin to our consciousness. So we decided, inspired by those ideas, we decided to perform the same analysis that I showed you before in historical texts. We were particularly interested in the moment of history called the Axial Age. This is a term coined by Carl Jaspers in the 50s point to this moment between 800 and 200 before Christ. This is wrong here, before Christ. As a moment of blossoming of human consciousness, as a moment, as you say, the coming of age of human consciousness. It's a moment in which many philosophers existed and wrote and left their words. And this is a moment which has been challenged historically as something that is interesting, but without any empirical basis. So we were particularly interested in seeing if the structure of the historical texts changed around the Axial Age. What we did was to sample 709 texts between 3000 before Christ and 2010 after Christ. I show you here the different traditions that were sampled. So in the Syro-Mesopotamian tradition, cuneiform in general, both Sumerian, Babylonian, Assyrian, Akkadian, we got 63 texts. In Egyptian, which is the longest of them, we got 49 texts. In the Judeo-Christian tradition, 76 texts. Hinduism, 37. Greco-Roman, 134. Much more availability of those. Persian, 19, including the Zoroastrian literature. Medieval, we got 20 modern, and 31 contemporaneous. I have to say that after you get, there's a lot of texts available in the internet, but once you get after the Middle Ages, after Gutenberg Press, then the availability of texts is much larger, and then your choice becomes much more arbitrary. So one control we did was to get many sets randomly chosen texts from the internet and compare the results, and it's pretty much similar to what I'm going to show to you now. Are you guys there? Or you left because you thought this is too
late? We're here.
Okay, good. So the first thing we did was to compare directly the data from the healthy and psychotic subjects with the data from pre-axial and post-axial literature. Axial meaning this period starting at 800 before Christ. What we found is that the number of nodes, for example, is lower in children below 12 years of education than in adults, as I showed before, lower in psychotics than in adults and healthy adults, and comparable to pre-axial literature, while post-axial literature shows results that are similar to healthy adults, but even above them. Okay, of course, the literature is a more erudite expression than the controls that we got here in Natal, Rio Grande do Norte. We see the opposite for repeated edges, right? You see a lot of repeated edges for children, less for adults, high for psychotic, high for pre-axial literature, and very low for post-axial literature. Then for LSC, the same pattern for nodes, right? Small in healthy subjects below 12 years of education. And this is not old, this is education actually. Here, this is adults, psychotics, pre-axial, post-axial. And the same thing for average shortest path. So what this is telling us is that if we use those four attributes as a pattern for immature and mature language structure, you can say that the psychotic subjects and the pre-axial literature are similar to immature, healthy structure, while the post-axial literature is similar to mature, healthy structure. It gets even to be more interesting when you look at this over time. So here you have in the x-axis time, years from Christ's birth, and in the y-axis, the number of nodes. And you see that this is increasing over time, and the saturation is in the future, okay? The saturation of this is not in the past, it's in the future. So this is actually, I think, a good message, right? And the graph size is also, this is saturating in 20,000 after Christ. This is saturating in 100,000 after Christ, the average shortest path. However, recurrence and connectedness have already saturated in the Bronze Age. Recurrence saturated early on. You can see that Egyptian and cuneiform texts had a lot of recurrence, like children, speech, and also like psychotic speech, and that decreases dramatically, and I'm going to show you where it decreases. And the LSC also can be very low, even like 5 for a window of 30 words, but then it saturates before Christ. I'm going to show you where. This is an interesting plot. This plot is showing you the normalized LSC, the LSC normalized by random values, by values of random graphs, and the normalized repeated edges, normalized by random values, but note that the axis is inverted because the maturation path is to decrease, not increase RE, okay? And what I'm showing here is the boundaries of the random values here at 1, and we color-coded the texts, each point, data point here is one text, we color-coded them with their estimated age. And what you can see, and it's very interesting in my opinion, is that two structural parameters, one that is about short-range recurrence, one that is about long-range recurrence, only two structural parameters seem to reconstitute the error of time, because you see that the correlation is pretty strong, and it's basically reconstituting the colors that I have here, blue on the left and red on the right. And you see here that this quadrant here in gray is the quadrant that really escapes from the, let's say, the random values, and that's where the modern, the contemporaneous literature exists. Contemporary literature exists. Finally, I want to show you this, and for me this was the most shocking thing. This is just the LSE divided by random, so it's normalized LSE, in using a sliding window of 200 years, and just showing you the data and showing boundaries for the Middle Bronze Age, for the collapse of the at the end of the Bronze Age, the beginning of Iron Age, and the Axial Age. And you can see here that the values, the variance was big, and then there was a decrease during the Middle Bronze Age. The year 2000 is a year of collapse also. It's a year of aridification in the Fertile Crescent. This is the year, 2004 is when the city of Ur collapses. The entire Sumerian civilization disappeared. The Akkadian civilization disappeared soon after Babylon becomes strong. This is the time of Hammurabi here. And then around the time of the War of Troy, there's another major collapse. It's the end of Crete. It's the end of the Mycenaean civilization. And then right after that, this is the Axial Age here. So you see there's a clear boundary. There's a clear increase in the LSE, which gets away from random values at around the year 800, and that is sustained to this date. So when Jasper said that this was the coming of age of consciousness, we could say that this is backed up by the structural data that I'm showing now. There was a clear change in the way the discourse was structured, going towards a pattern that we now measure in mature adults, but not in children and not in psychotic. So children and psychotic patients are much more similar to what we find in the Bronze Age. So the off-the-wall conclusion that I want to draw here is that structural randomness seems to be an immature trace of language, both individually as well as historically. And I want to thank the many bodies that fund our research, the Pew Foundation, the Neuromats, it's now becoming a long-time association, very good for us to be part of the Neuromats. The FAPERN, I shouldn't credit the FAPERN because this is the equivalent of FAPESP in Rio Grande do Norte. They completely stopped paying anything, but you know, we got some money from them in the past. CNPq and CAPES seem to be in the same situation, but in any event, we hope they will be revived. This is a picture of part of the Brain Institute, and we need to credit also the different projects. We got historical texts mostly from the Project Gutenberg, which is the oldest digital library available, the Digital Egypt for Universities, the Electronic Text Corpus of Sumerian Literatures. And of course, we got data from clinical hospitals here, from psychiatric hospitals, as well as from schools. So we are part of a project called Acerta from CAPES, which is about literacy. And last but not least, I want to thank the LASCUL, the Latin American School for Education, Cognitive and Neurosciences, where some of these ideas developed. This is data for the future, for further discussion. Thank you very much.
Questions?
Okay, Siddhartha, there are maybe probably lots of other explanations for that break that you see in the historical record. Like, I mean, one thing that occurs to me is that maybe it is when literacy stopped being the privilege of priests and maybe royalty and become something that was spread around the entire population. I mean, more people started writing and reading because maybe the technology of writing with paper and this thing. I think paper maybe become common maybe around that epoch, that time, between 1,000 years before Christ and time of Christ. So maybe, how have you excluded those other possibilities?
No, it's quite the opposite. This is exactly what Jasper said. What Jasper said is that around the year 800, there was a renaissance after a big crisis. There was a renaissance that spanned the Ganges Valley to pretty much Italy, okay? And this renaissance involved common notions of money, common notions of trade, common notions of political system. It's the big age of empires and even the beginning of democracy. This is also the notion of introspection. This is the notion that you have something inside you that you need to talk to. And this is what Jane says. Jane says, until then, people were talking to the gods. And after then, people were talking to themselves. Okay, and having better support and having a democratization of literacy was certainly part of this. This is part of Jasper's argument. However, this is not a linear argument, because in each city, the story comes, it goes up and down, it goes up and down. If you follow the city of Thebes, for example, you have it goes up, and then there's economic development, and then literacy goes up, and there's a collapse, it goes down again. And this can actually be traced. There's a paper by our colleagues, Guillermo Cecchi, also a member of Neuromat, using semantic analysis, showing this for Judeo-Christian traditions, that introspection becomes much more common in the texts and then drops. And then the same thing from Greco-Roman, it goes up and then drops. He used Google engrams to do sort of cultural history in the 20th century, and he shows the introspection goes up in the books until the first war, and then it goes down. And then it goes up again, and then in 37 starts to go down, second war, and then goes up again, and starts to go down after the year 2000, for whatever that matters. So yes, what you're saying is quite true. This is the whole hypothesis. Jasper says that we became ourselves in the last millennium before Christ. In the recent years, people have been saying this is bullshit. There's no evidence of that. I think our data speaks to the contrary.
So actually, my question was very much in the lines of what Stofi just asked. And in a complementary way, I wonder if you have ever analyzed differences between speech patterns in religious current contemporary religious texts and regular other speech patterns, and also if there might be expected to find a difference in what. Because I think in my reasoning, it's relevant to see where who produces the text, because on account of the old shamanic importance of the expression and registering prophecies and so on and so forth. And I wonder if it's still present in current religious production, or even in more tribal people.
Excellent question, Ludmila. So interesting. Well, first of all, the texts that we get from Egypt and from Sumeria and from Babylon are texts by very educated people. In fact, the first schools of humankind were invented in Sumeria. They were called edubas. And most of the texts that linger have to do with teaching, have to do with scolding students for not paying attention, this kind of stuff. But yes, religion is a possible, you could say, well, the text became less religious. So it's not the case. In the Judeo-Christian tradition, it's all religious. In the Zoroastrian tradition, it's all religious. Most of the Middle Age texts are religious, and yet they have the contemporary structure, not the old structure. Okay? Now, we compared the data to poetry, because we said maybe this has to do with just the paragraphization and the way the text is broken. And we found that poetry is quite different. So Sumerians and Egyptians occupy a very different space. If you use those structural attributes as axes for a space, they occupy a very special sub-quadrant. They are separate from poetry and separate from contemporary. If you compare Hammurabi to Plato, Hammurabi is very different from Plato. And Plato is very close to Voltaire, very close to Dostoevsky, very close to Michel Laub, if you want. Okay, so it's in the past, since the Axial Age, we've been very similar. Now we're exploring this. Currently, we're exploring this with indigenous tribes. So we started a collaboration last month with Luis Fernando Toffoli, a psychiatrist in Campinas, who put us in contact with Antonio Guerreiro, an anthropologist that studies the, in particular the Kalapalu, and he sent us data for 20, he has a lot of recordings, and he sent us data for 20 subjects, adult subjects, and it's very interesting. They are very, very close to the Sumerians and to the Egyptians, but they are not quite there. They have their own space. Okay, so they're close to Sumerians and Egyptians, but they have their own space. And this is, of course, they don't have writing. It's oral tradition. So now we are starting to interact with people in Argentina to try to get a big database of data from indigenous tribes, as well as from illiterate people around the big cities. Okay, people that are modern, contemporary in any way, except they don't read and write, and to try to figure it out, you know, what is going on. But this is, it seems to us that we hit a nerve here, because everything that we plot seems to have their own little place, you know. So it seems like you can do a taxonomy of those traditions using these structural features.
Hi, Siddhartha. How are you doing? So I'm not sure you can see me. This is Roberto Imbuzeiro from here.
Roberto, tudo bom?
Tudo bom. So yeah, the talk looks incredibly interesting. I'm wondering, sort of on the technical side, what kinds of statistical tests you actually performed to ascertain that the difference is actually there. So I can see some error bars in some of the plots, but I'm not sure if you performed any tests or anything like that too.
So, well, here we started performing ANOVA and t-test, but then we actually moved to Crosco Wallace and Wilcoxon, ranked some correct for comparisons. It's very clear the differences are very, very significant.
Yeah.
And here we tried to, what we did was to fit an exponentially saturating curve and compute the correlation coefficient and the p-values. And what I actually, in this particular one here, is easier to see that. In the cases when they were not significant, I did not influence the characteristic time. We chose this model here because it gives us this characteristic time. So, okay. and because it also fits the development, we know that those things saturate. Mm-hmm. Okay, but I'm not claiming that this is the best representation of the data. I'm saying if I use that representation, it's useful because I can compare. I can clearly say, well, the saturation age for lexical diversity is much less than the saturation age for, say, LSE.
Okay, makes sense. Yeah. All right, thanks.
That's it. Christoph. Hi, Siddhartha. I'm a bit surprised by some of your claims about the Assyrian and Mesopotamian text, because as far as I know, most of the literature we have is in fact not literature, but trade texts. So it's just contract.
There's plenty of literature. The oldest text is called Instructions to Shurupag. It's 3,000 years, and it's a text of a person telling the son what to do and not what not to do.
Sure, but I mean, if you look at the sample of text we have, most of the stuff we have is just Mr. A sold this field to Mr. B with and so on and so on. So then you expect lots of repetitions in this.
But this is not what we used.
So if you compare Gilgamesh with the Iliad or some later mythical adventures, do you see a difference or not? And how do you cope with the fact that you will have some translations? Or
so the first question is, if you compare Gilgamesh, Hammurabi, and Shurupag are all old style. They all have a lot of local recurrences and few in a small long range recurrence. Okay, so they are, if you look at the data, and we only got text that was prose, that was not clearly poetry, and certainly not accounting. Okay, and you can find a good deal of text in those digital libraries that I indicated, which are hosted by universities. Now, translation is a major problem, and it's a problem that we sort of have to deal with, because we don't have, it depends on for some texts we can actually go to the originals, but because the program, the software does not care whether the word is in Portuguese or in any language. But for hieroglyphics, for example, we can't. Okay, so then we have to deal with translation. What we're doing now is two things. One is to, well, we're using all the translations to English. So this is one reference point. And we have previous work published with the psychiatric diagnosis stuff, showing that if we translate the patient's reports to English, Spanish, French, German, and Italian, and then recalculate the graphs and do the analysis, we get pretty much the same results. So it seems to be robust to a simple, at least within the Western Indo-European languages. The second thing we're doing is we're going after originals whenever possible. And we haven't finished this analysis, but because we're sending the paper right now, and this is one of the, we sent it to Stanislas Dehaene, and he suggested that we included that. And that's what we're doing. We hope to find a good correlation there that would keep this caveat low.
So last question here by Andre.
Siddhartha, if you apply the same idea that you apply in all these texts for texts produced in different languages, what occur? You have this difference on the thinking about the contemporary production in different languages.
I'm not sure I understand the question. Is this the same question about translation?
No, it's not translation. If you take the books on the produced in different languages, in English, in Portuguese, in French, in you have difference on this kind of patterns?
No, that's what I explained before. I mean, if I get the book from Agualusa, okay, current contemporary writer from Angola, and I get the Portuguese and the English, they have very, very similar structures.
No.
But I'm not sure this is true for a translation of a hieroglyphic text. That's a whole different story.
But the point is not the translation. If you take the production, the contemporary production in different languages, you have different patterns in this kind of analysis that you applied.
No, that's what I'm saying.
They are exactly the same. It's a much more historical process than a language process.
So if you look at the data here, Can you see my cursor? The red data is books from, this is Voltaire, this is Hume, this is like authors from the 17th, 16th, 18th century. Then in white we have authors from 19th, 20th century. You see the dynamic range is pretty small compared to what you see here for, you know, the Iliad, the Odyssey, you know, this kind of stuff here, or even before, Gilgamesh here, okay? So you have a very wide dynamic range here. And here you have a compression here. So now, note that for the new data, for the internet data, this is the black is the data collected, books that are available on the internet. It seems to be larger. Now we need to get a lot more. We need to study just that to see if this is just not a fluctuation of these two data points here. What I'm confident to say is that after the year 800, you can actually see the translation here. After this period, all the texts convert. Here you have a lot of Zoroastrian religious stuff. Oh, by the way, this is the Quran.
We cannot see it. We cannot see it. Tell us where.
The Quran is this isolated red dot here. It's pretty low in terms of connectivity.
But Siddhartha, I was interested on this question because when you see the contemporary production, that's the black points, you have a large variation from 10 to maybe 17. And the point is, if this variation is related to the language that the production was wrote.
I don't think so. Well, this is all, well, I don't think so, but I don't have data to positively say no, maybe in a month. But I should say that I think there is a big difference. I think there's something going on after the internet. I think that if we get a lot, if we just do a study on before and after the internet, I think we're going to see a decrease in the long range recurrence. People are speaking in shorter, it's a Twitter effect. I think we are sort of getting that into the way people communicate, but that's a hypothesis to be tested.
Okay, so I think Sergio wants to have a last question here.
The difficult question. When you mentioned about consciousness, talking about your last slide, What do you mean exactly?
My last slide was about consciousness.
Now you said the word, and then there was this discontinuity. Can you show the, because I do not remember the ratio, but is the, you said the most important one. Before? Exactly here. So the other one, the next one. You said this, consciousness. You said.
I said that our data seems to speak to the notion that Carl Jaspers had that human consciousness changed in the last millennium before Christ.
And how
we have data on the structure of the texts left by these people that say that something changed dramatically between the collapse of the Bronze Age and the beginning of the Axial Age. That's what I believe.
And this is related to consciousness?
Well, if we want
idea to, of self.
Mental archaeology is trying to infer what the people in the past thought. We can read those texts and we can get a lot of information about how they thought by reading them. But here we are doing a different thing. We're measuring not what they said, but how they said it. And we can say that the way they said things changed dramatically around that time. Now, the way you say things in psychiatry is what you use to infer thought, to infer a process that comes from your consciousness. So in that sense, in only in that sense, we believe that we can do mental archaeology and infer previous mental states or previous consciousness states.
Thank you. Okay. So I think that's all, because it's already half past 10. So we thank Siddhartha again. Let's go. Thank you, Siddhartha, very much. Great talk. Now we have a coffee break, and then we resume after that.
Okay? Drink one for me.
Yeah, thank you very much.
Our next picture will be André Frazão, and he will explain us the Amparo Network.
Hi. Hello. Firstly, I need to say that it's a pleasure to be here. And I am a biologist, and I work with basic science. And I will present a tentative to make an effort that could produce a very good connection between basic science and clinical approach. That's the Neuromat Parkinson Network that we call Amparo. And it's all related with Parkinson research and Parkinson application on clinical. And maybe to start, we can remember or to talk about what is exactly is Parkinson. Parkinson disease is a progressive neurodegenerative disorder that's related with many many symptoms as tremor, rigidity, bradykinesia, and postural instability. And all those symptoms are related with dopaminergic loss neurons and in the nigrostriatal regions in basal ganglia. And this characterization is related with this kind of systems where the dopaminergic cells are involved that control movement in a process that's related to cortex, but is a subcortical group of areas, and where the dopaminergic loss involves the enhancement of inhibitory effects on thalamus. And all those are related only to movement, and that's why when we see, sorry about this kind of characterization of symptoms, we talk about motor disability. But we know that many other different aspects are related and symptoms are related to Parkinson, and I will show a kind of that group of disorders. And Parkinson is important to Brazil. Parkinson is the second most prevalent neurodegenerative disease. And in Brazil, considering the change in longevity of population, and here you can see the life expectancy in Brazil in last 30 years, we can see that we move from 60 to 75 years. And that is very important because a lot of neurodegenerative disease will occur, is expected to occur when you have this kind of behavior in the life expectancy. And that's important because we will see a lot of different new and old disabilities in a large occurrence since we have this kind of change. As we told, the basic idea is related to the motor control, but it's not only motor control involved on this kind of disability. If we see a lot of non-motor symptoms occurs on Parkinson's disease, and that involves during the if we can see this kind of not motor symptoms, we can organize in maybe three groups of different non-motor symptoms that involve even more simple not non-motor symptoms until a lot of dementia problems and cognitive problems. And that occurs if we think from the first moments of the disease. Even to the more prolonged occurrence of the disease. And we are trying in the project to understand this kind of symptomatology and pass into the progression of the disease and how we can not only think about the interventions and in the way that normally we think the basic action of science, but thinking about other aspects as the community development and the health education and how we can act in this kind of field. And since this, we promote the Amparo initiative that try to make a strong effort in community development, and that can be defined as not only the clinical, but a lot of different, the involvement of different groups of society, the governments and economic, social and other social and economic sectors, non-governmental societies, voluntary organizations, and others. And we did that in a first approach, make a strong relation with the Associação Brasil Parkinson. That's the biggest association in Parkinson disease in Brazil, that has more than 6,000 members living with Parkinson disease. And it's very interesting because they have a strong relation with the Parkinson disease, the patients. And we can make a different approach considering that. At this moment, we have three main goals: to identify how people with Parkinson's disease live, what was the obstacles found by the professionals, and the contributions to change the positively the reality of the Parkinson's disease patients. We have the meetings that we are organizing. We had two meetings on the last month. On next week, we will have two other meetings to discuss some important aspects to the patients. And you can find on the website these meetings. And you can, on the, it's not able to see the moment of the meetings, but anyone can participate of these meetings. And the idea of each one of these meetings is to engage not only the scientific staff, but the clinical and also the Parkinson's disease patients to discuss all these aspects that we are talking here. So, identify how people with Parkinson's disease lives and
trying to contribute to change positively this reality. And we also trying to make some intervention in health education about that. And I will show three different approaches on that. The first one was work that we did sometimes ago, 2 years ago, 4 years ago, that was the trying to understand how the progression, the effects of progression of Parkinson's disease are involved in three different dimensions of the disruption. Disruption of implicit knowledge acquisition, cognitive impairment, and motor disability or motor impairment. And that was important because, as I said, normally we try to understand only considering the motor impairment, the Parkinson's disease, but we know that cognitive and implicit memory are important also. And when we said this kind of distribution of the relations between these three dimensions of disabilities, it's possible to see that some of those, especially cognitive, have a non-linear progression that could be very difficult to understand in a general sense to explain how the disease involved the different disabilities. The second aspect that we did was trying to make some effort to make strategies that involve explicit guided actions on Parkinson's disease live. That's based on the idea that if we have two kind of memories, and that's a classical way to describe long-term memory, we have in Parkinson's disease patients an implicit disruption, but maintenance of explicit, and that make feasible that we use explicit strategies to enhance the movement execution, not guided by implicit, but guided by explicit strategies. I will show some of the videos. I think it's very interesting, and I hope that works. And only to show, we have some patients trying to do these movements and without and with this kind of strategy guided by explicit rules. This is a patient trying to walk. And, and that's a patient walking, and here without our strategy guided by explicit rules, and you can see all the movement disabilities involved in Parkinson have a strong difficulty to walk. And we have other videos here trying to wake up in the bed. And all those problems are related with this kind of disability, the motor disability, the incapacity to produce a group of movements, and trying to solve this kind of, or treat this kind of problem, with Marie-Lise Piemont developed a approach that the patients try to do the same tasks now guided by explicit, and you can see that we have a strong change in this kind of the main idea here, Claudia, is if you have this problem with producing a group of actions that you need to put in a sequence to make the correct movement, and that's what occurs when you have this kind of problem related to dopaminergic loss. If you can guide this same action in a small part of actions, you can do the same group of actions guided by action and by guided by attention and guided by explicit rules. And that's the approach. Yeah, that's the idea. To walk, you need to first, that's the idea. You need to walk, you need to first get up the feet and then move the... No, all those patients are with medication. And they are all with L-DOPA, L-DOPA, and but in both the situations, in the first one and the second one, they are using L-DOPA. And at this moment, considering exactly the medication, we are trying, we are finishing an article that involves exactly the effects of, I don't explain very well this graph, and here we have the expected disruption or impairment involving dopaminergic and without dopaminergic and drugs. And at this moment, we are trying to understand what happens exactly with this kind of task when we have we don't have the medication, and we are finishing this article. Other thing that we are trying to think is about the possibility to understand not the entire action of something complex as walk, but how the people, how the patients learn the implicit abilities as producing sequence. If we see what happened with the people that that those are different sequence, and those are different sequence here we've calculate the entropy of the sequence, and here what occur when you have the training during a lot of blocks of training. And we are trying to see if it's this kind of task is permits that you can see the difference in the capacity to engage different actions and different in a whole sequence to produce the better movement. And all we are trying to do involves the tentative to evaluate what occurs here, not only in the during the progression, not when you have installed the motor disabilities, that is when you can see the you can make the diagnosis, but if we can develop some approaches to evaluate before that it's possible to make the diagnosis. And that's one of the possibilities that we are trying to make. And all those involves this kind of idea that we can make health promotion, considering health education, considering community development and interventions, and considering that all those kind of knowledge can produce something in public policy of health. And that's the general idea that we are trying to do with Amparo at this moment. Thank you.
Hello. We have time for several questions.
These questions, I must ask it. So Marie-Lisa and you have been doing this for some time, mm-hmm. even before Neuromat existed. So Neuromat is using your previous experience and activity. Now, what the mathematicians and statisticians in Neuromat can do to help you in those activities that you have been doing already? Mm-hmm.
I think we have two important aspects. Firstly, it's a good idea to evaluate the EEG in a premotor phase of the
in this premotor phase period of the disease that could be very important to make some evaluations to diagnose. That could be very important. And this is, we truly need the mathematicians involved in the EEG analysis to do that, especially considering the connection with cortical and other and different cortical structures involving motor cortex. And the second one, because when we are discussing, when I show this kind of graph, I think we have a better way to understand how people learn the abilities with this kind of analysis than those that we did apply it before, as in this paper that we published. The graph here is, we have different sequence, and here is the reaction time for the sequence involves you press different buttons in different sequence. And what we put here is what happened during the blocks. Then you have the training, the initial blocks, and then you have the training. And what occurs when you have the training is that the reaction time for different entropies of the sequence, we characterize the sequence using the entropy, you can see that this moves, the time moves. And then what you have is with the same entropy in different moments of the training, taking specifically a sequence, specifically with entropy 2, you can see in the block, in the initial blocks, you have a large time than in the last blocks. And what's here is all this process occurring along the training. And here is what happened with each one of the possible ways to describe the curve. The epsilon max, that's the point here, and the half point, and you can see that this change, and the epsilon minimum, and that's the idea that's present here.
Question.
My question is similar to Galvis' question. What are people of a theoretical computational people could connect with the this Amparo project? I'm thinking, perhaps I have an idea, for example. Probably there is literature about modeling Parkinson's disease, right, by computational models. And perhaps we need to start or with the computational theoretical people start to study literature of neurological and psychiatric models, and at least we will gain familiarity, we will gain about this kind of problems. So perhaps the connection could be start to think about how to model based in a literature that already exists.
I think one of the most important efforts that we are doing now involves the goalkeeper game. And it's a very friendly platform to analyze the data with the Parkinson's disease patients. And that could be very interesting to analyze how the patients related with this kind of sequence, not involving the entropy, but involving the structures of the sequence in a very friendly platform. That's one of the important aspects. And I think that we will produce some data, as you told, or some data that can explain how patients learn and how patients can produce predictions on a sequence.
Empowering is started, I guess, 3 months ago, something like this. It was an effort to put together the scientific research we have been doing and the efforts we have been doing in parallel. So now we have a small experience. We have already 2 lessons, next one next week. And obviously, Amparo was a motivation for us to think about Abraço. And Abraço will be the topic to discuss later. What kind of difference you can see between these two initiatives? What kind of lesson we can take from Amparo to help us planning Abraço?
I believe that Amparo has an interesting aspect, that's the involvement of Associação Brasil Parkinson, that involves a large number of patients. And that could be very interesting, because those patients are distributed in all places of Brazil. That could be very important to make this approach, considering the evaluation of what's happening with Parkinson's disease patients in Brazil. And that kind of effort could be very nice if it's possible to apply to Abraço, I think. I'm not sure, because we have a strong difference between those two cases, but I think that could be very interesting. And other important aspect is, if we have the same platform, this friendly platform to make the data collection, and that could be very important. If we compare Parkinson with the impairment associated with the lesions of plexus, we have a complementary problem. Here we have a subcortical problem, and there we have a problem with the peripheral aspects that involve primarily the cortical. And that could be very important to make those simultaneously. But they are, both are new, and we need to think a lot of how to make this kind of efforts come together.
André, you know that since the Neuromatch launching, we have been pretty much concerned about how to database all this information for instance, for brachial plexus injury patients. How do you see these efforts coming in Parkinson's disease?
We have now, for those, for this work with the patients without the medication, we have something like 160 patients involved. And I am truly engaged on the tentative to convince the people to make this data, all the data, because those patients are in clinical and have all the evaluations done on the database. I'm not sure if we are able to do that, considering especially the clinical limitations that we normally find in this kind of effort. But I am a very enthusiastic person, and I think it will be possible. It's all I can say now. But I believe, with the Associação Brasil Parkinson, it's much more easy to do that, because we don't have this kind of limitation done by the clinical normal procedures.
Okay. Next question.
Thank you. First of all, congratulations. It's a really great project. So my question is, we know from the literature, from our previous experience, that we have a lot of levels of this disease. We use the Hong-Yar scale, which classified the patients from 1 to 5, where 1 is onset of the disease, and 5, the patient is not able to walk anymore. So my question is, in this project, you work with just patients from 1 to 3 level, and patients with who are classified from 4 and 5, you don't work, or?
Yeah, thank you for that. And that's very interesting question, because we work with only patients 1 to 3.
Okay.
The problem is 4 and 5, it's on bed.
Yes.
And it's very interesting because our first effort was to use the ONER scale to classify the performance, and that don't work. Only it's even a problem, because ONER don't explain the progression of disease. Then we are, the first effort was trying to use, and now we don't use. But when this is the first clinical approach to classify, then we have only 1 to 3.
Yeah, because you know from the literature that it's been really useful when we think about the progression of the disease. Yeah, my second question is, you showed us this slide showing that you have assessed patients with upper limb impairment. I would like to know if you also assess patients with gait problem. Yeah, patients who are not able to walk very well, or patients who have a risk of falling, things like that, because this kind of learning is just for upper limb,
just
to check skills for upper limb.
Yeah.
But you have any other assessment for gait or lower limb in general?
Yes, we have some. We do also the some for walking, and a lot of measures of walking, as the steps, the size of the step, and the velocity that the person can walk, and things like that. But we don't have the data organized as that, and I don't know how to compare both. That's very interesting to even to know if they correlated, the upper limb and other aspects correlated. And now we are trying to use the UPDRS, that's much more better classification for the scale. And but that's a very interesting question, the point.
Okay, let's thank our speaker again.
Thank you.
So thank you for the opportunity to come here in this nice workshop to show my work. It's a part of my PhD thesis, and it's a joint work with Claudio Queiroz from the Brain Institute, the Federal University of Rio Grande do Norte. Also a joint work with Nathan Kutz from the University of Washington. I've been there this year for a sandwich PhD. So I've been there 3 months working with him. And also with my advisor, Roberto Imbuzeiro. So the idea is to give to the neuroscientists a tool for seizure detection. So a simple mathematical tool so the neuroscience can avoid or can detect the beginning, the onset of the seizure, and then stop it by electrical stimulation or drug. Our data set, it's a polycarpine model of temporal lobe epilepsy. We have 4 mice and 19 seizures. Each seizure has 32 channels, 23, 24 in the hippocampus, plus ECOG and EMG channels. The sampling rate for some seizures are 1 kHz or 2 kHz. Okay, so this is the picture of a seizure. This is a full LFP recording, and here you have a zoom. Sorry. Here you have a zoom of a seizure, and it's interesting to see the different frequency patterns that you have around the seizure in the onset, and also here in the end, this burst activity. So frequency of the LFP recording is changing with time during the seizure, especially. So just to briefly, I'm sorry, this light should be better. The width should be higher. just to say, we have a filtering data methodology just to apply the Fourier transform, the shift Fourier transform, and then multiply by a filter function, which cuts the frequency higher than 600 hertz and also smooth a little bit. So you have a zoom here. It's not, I'm not sure if it's good to see, but you have cutting very, very high frequencies and also smoothing. It's a very light filter just to get the main frequencies of our data. Okay, and so this is the our methodology for a window of WS seconds. You can transform it in a data matrix and compute the SVD decomposition of a matrix. It's a very simple linear algebra calculation. This is the LFP data. So I put that in a matrix and I compute the SVD decomposition of the data matrix of the local field potential, not the Fourier. Okay. Just for filtering, okay? And then you get back the inverse Fourier. So once you have the filtered data, you can transform it in a data matrix, compute the SVD decomposition. No? Okay. The SVD decomposition is the singular value decomposition. It's a decomposition where you divide the matrix in three matrix, where the first matrix have the spatial modes, and sigma is a matrix, a diagonal matrix, which has the singular values. So the important information that we're going to use here is this diagonal matrix. The singular values are numbers that represent the data, represent the energy of the data. So for instance, if you normalize by the sum of the singular values, you have the energy distribution of them. Okay? So you can fit. Here we choose a Pareto function, Pareto density function, to fit the distribution of the singular values. Okay. Of course, for this fitting process, we have a result, which is the alpha parameter, and this will be a score for our distribution. So, in an example, for very fast decay distribution, you have high alphas. And this means that data has a low dimensional nature. For instance, if you have just one singular value, it means that in some sense it's a one-dimensional data. So it's more generalized. It represents more generalized activity in the brain or synchronization. But if you have low alpha or a more slow decaying distribution, you have more complex structure in your data. Okay. And that means localized activity or desynchronization. So our procedure here is to choose a sliding window that, with an overlap of this parameter, WG, also in seconds. So for instance, in this example, you have WS of 4 seconds, and then you slide it 1 second. And then you can compute a series of the alpha parameters. Okay, so just as a sanity check, I'm sorry if you're not used to this complex or this mathematical formulation. It's a simple model of synchronization, the Kuramoto model, just to test the sanity of our methodology. Theta here are couple it's the phase of the oscillator, and you pick the cosine of this oscillator. They are coupled, and this parameter k measures the strength of the coupling. Okay, this is just for an example, an illustrative example, and you can see that for a synchronized activity, our alpha values are close to one. In this example, you have a 24 node and a 0.01 noise. Put all the natural frequencies as one, all the initial phases starting together. So synchronized activity, alpha is closer than one. Otherwise, if you have random distributed natural frequencies and initial phase, you can have, on average 0.5 alpha series. So it reminds us, for those who know, it reminds the order parameter of the Kuramoto model. But this methodology picks information from the past WS seconds. So it's a little bit different, but it's consistent with what we are using to do. Okay, so this is our results. We compute the alpha T series for the channels in the hippocampus, and this is the general picture. When it comes to the seizure, you have this phenomena in the alpha T series, and if you zoom, if you put a window here, should be bigger width also. But if you zoom this window, you have this pattern here. In the onset of the seizure, you have a drop in the value of the alpha. And in the end, in the burst activity in the end, it becomes higher. And this pattern happens for most of the seizure, almost 80% of the seizures, okay? And this means that the onset of the seizure is characterized by a desynchronized activity. And this is this surprising, because the literature used to say that seizure is just high synchronization in the brain, but here we found for most of the seizures, it begins with a high desynchronization and then high synchronization in the end, okay? These results are robust respect to the window parameters, and also the least square fitting of the alpha. It's quite low, it's about 0.05. There's just a bump here, but it's not very bad. Sorry? Oh, it happens a few seconds, like this. In this case, I believe it's about 5 to 8 seconds before this high amplitude regime. So if you mark the beginning of the seizure by the first spike before this this depression here, you see this dropping alpha just before. So it's about the first seconds of the seizure. So that's why, I'll keep talking, but that's why seizure detection is something that we are interested with this methodology. Okay, just one more qualitative result. If you see the time series of the alpha, you see that the post-ictal phase is slightly higher than the pre-ictal. So we put a window time of the big T minutes, and we plot some histograms that show us that there is a slighted histogram in the post-seizure epoch, which means that after the seizure, the brain is more synchronized for 10 minutes here, the 10-minute window. Okay, it's also for 1 minute, but especially this 10-minute window is very interesting. And we observe this for the majority of the seizures. And this highlights the importance of the post-ictal depression in the brain. So the seizure has a long-term impact in the brain, and this result shows it. So this is a work in progress. We are now working on the seizure detection algorithm, and we want to take advantage of these time signatures of this alpha T series to apply some technique to machine learning techniques, something to recognize these patterns and then training and then testing against new data. So this is one thing that we are doing now. And we are also asking ourselves about what happens with the seizures where, for instance, the alpha time series doesn't drop. This is just an example of one of such seizures. You have a low alpha values through the time series. And we would like to know if there are some neurological information that we can retrieve from this pattern here. Are there some special features in these seizures? So the alpha behaves like this. So these are some things that I'm working on. Okay, that's it. So I want to talk.
We have time for a few questions.
The absence of decrease in the alpha value, is it linked to the animal?
Sorry?
You said you have four mice in your sample. So do you see that one?
No.
No, so it's not.
No, there is no relation. Okay. Not no apparent relation between the mouse and the this dropping alpha.
Questions?
Very interesting. My question: do you think it's possible to apply this technique to local field potential in other conditions, in other brain states, linked to perception, for instance, or to attention? Because this is the first question. I see you analyze only one trace of field potential, although you have 32 channels.
Yes, we have.
The analysis applied individually for.
No. We pick everything, put in a single matrix, like this. Here, sorry. You put all the channels in a data matrix where the rows are the channels and the columns are the time evolution. So for this matrix, we compute this decomposition. So you need to put all the channels in a row of the matrix.
And do you have an estimative of how many channels you need in order to?
In theory, you need just for you need at least two. I mean, yes, for computing this. Yes, yes, you need at least two. But there's no limits. There's no upper limit. You can do.
Could you use spiking data instead of local field potential by, making a convolution of the spiking data, obtaining a continuous signal, and applying the same technique. It's just ideas of is possible to use these concepts in different contexts.
Yeah, no.
Not related to.
Yeah, once you have data, evolution of data in time, you can put in a matrix like this. Once you frame your problem in such a matrix, then the rest is straightforward, just to apply the singular value decomposition. So it could be any kinds of recording data. Could be, yes. As long as you can put in a data matrix.
Did you use thresholded values to detect when the alpha values are low or high? And if this is the case, how did you select those values?
Yes, that's something that we are working now, is to use thresholds. First, normalize the alpha series, and then use thresholds to detect the seizure, for instance. But for this observation here, we just use a visual analysis, and because it's a very distinct pattern, it happens in almost all the seizures. So this is a visual analysis, more visual. But now we are working on how to create a criteria for stopping the seizures, a universal criteria that should fit to all the seizures.
Okay, thank you.
We have time for one question more.
Very interesting. If I understood correctly, so the surprise is that you first find a short period in which you have desynchronization.
Yes.
So we could ask that maybe this is a kind of balance in the dynamics for a dynamical system of some type. When you have a desynchronization, you then you have a dynamic effort to retrieve the normal. Do you believe that's true? Do you have an explanation for this?
Yeah, it's a very interesting observation. From the dynamical system point of view, we could reframe this as a balance of attractors of a dynamical system. I don't have an explanation for this, but I mean, Claudio saw this as the first time I was in the US, and he was really, really happy. And he was saying something like that. I always knew that. And he's also working with other results that show this desynchronization. But yeah, it would be nice to find an explanation, simple explanation for this balance.
Okay, well, so let's thank our speaker again. And our next speaker is with Claudia Vargas and her group on Amparo Network. Abraço Network.
Thank you, Fernando. So, first of all, I would like to thank very much for the opportunity for my team to be here presenting our work today. In fact, I'm Claudia Vargas. I'm a professor at the Federal University of Rio de Janeiro and the head of the Laboratory of Neuroscience and Rehabilitation, and also principal investigator of Neuromat since its inception. So, in my lab, we are interested in how the brain controls movements and also how the brain changes after peripheral lesions. So, back in time, I brought you a picture from a paper published by Schieber in 2001, and this is a drawing from Penfield archive. As you may know, Penfield was a Canadian neurosurgeon who was the first to map systematically the body in the brain, the sensory motor representation in the patient's cerebral cortex. He was working with patients who had severe epilepsy, and one way to access this loci, epileptical loci at that time, we didn't have this nice methodology that you are developing now. So what the surgeons did at that time was to stimulate the cortical surface with electrodes to identify possible regions of epileptical foci. So this is a nice drawing from Penfield's work, showing that it was evident that each time you stimulate in this region of the cortex called just in front of the central sulcus, it was possible to evoke movements of the body in a systematic way. The same for the sensory part of the cerebral cortex, where it was possible to evoke sensations in a systematic way, quite systematic way. So this was done 70 years ago, and till nowadays we work with the concepts and the phenomenology which was presented at that time. Of course, some new empirical data come, some new concepts came from that time to now, but to answer Fernando's question, why do people which are interested in motor control and rehabilitation, what these people are doing in Neuromat? So my answer to you is that we are interested in moving forward, in having new concepts, new ideas to move forward on how the brain represents movements. This so sophisticated function, which is producing skilled movements, and also to have new models to understand what happens in the brain when you have a peripheral lesion, which can be so devastating for a person. So it's a very long-range project, as you may imagine. And Hawk is shaking his head like this. but then why the brachial plexus lesion patients? So then I bring you to the anatomy of an epidemic, which is now spread all over the big cities in the world. So it's not very clear, but here is a depiction of the evolution of motorcycle accidents in the great cities, in Brazilian cities. So you can see here, this is in red. So it's really, as the paper of this publication says, it's becoming epidemics. And one of the consequences of motorcycle accidents is lesioning the nerves which provide sensory motor information to the upper limb. So this is the brachial plexus. Vicente is going to talk a little bit more in detail on the dysfunctions that associate with this lesion. So just in brief, this is a devastating sensory motor condition with the high functional incapacity of the upper limb. Within Neuromat, we have been interested in how we can map these changes in the brain after a peripheral lesion. So this is just a pile of information. I won't have time to go in very much detail on what this work has shown, but just to tell you that we took data from Martin Malesi's team in Leiden. This was resting state data, and within Neuromat, what we did was to investigate the correlations between the voxels, the units within each of the regions in the primary motor cortex of these patients as compared to a group of control subjects. So this graph shows the correlations between these voxels as a function of distance. And as you can see, as expected, these correlations decay as a function of distance between the voxels. The black corresponds to control subjects, and in the purple, the results found for the brachial plexus lesion patients. So it was clear that this condition produces a devastating alteration of these local relationships between voxels in the region corresponding to not only of the upper limb, but also the trunk. So this is something that we are now very interested in understanding. For the region in the motor cortex corresponding to the face representation, there was no difference between controls and patients. These effects were also found in the hemisphere contralateral to the sparred limb. So this is also an interesting point, an important point to try to understand and to put in our model. So, yes. So here, Marcio, what we are looking at is the distance between voxels. This was data taken from the patient who goes to an fMRI machine, and he's just resting there, and then you collect the basal activity within each voxel. So what we are looking at here is the correlation between these voxels as a function of distance. Say I'm taking a voxel here, and I look at all the neighbors correlation between all the neighbors. Okay, so as if the closer they are, more correlated they are, and then if you go further, but this is within each one of these regions here. Okay, thank you for asking. So the way we interpret these results still also lie on this simple concepts that come also from experimental animals, where there would be a balance between excitation and inhibition in the cortex, which is disrupted by the lesions. So this is the way we interpret, we understand this effect still nowadays. But we want to move forward. So as I said before, so within Neuromat, since its inception, we stated some goals. The first one was to build a virtual data bank, a database, which will be presented. Some of these results will be presented by Juliana. We are also going to discuss more on it this afternoon with Kelly. So this gave rise to this initiative of building the database for Neuromat and in a specific format that we will talk later on. We also will present some new projects in the initial stage on how to investigate cortical plasticity using the tools that are available nowadays for the experimenters, so EEG, TMS, MRI. And we would really like to move forward on, as I said, and developing modeling of cortical reorganization. We search for rules of cortical plasticity, so to say. So this is just a drawing of the kind of lesion of on the nerves which are mostly affected by the brachial plexus lesion, and this will be the talk of Vicente Martins. And besides, it's okay. I want to make it short. We also are now on the way of building this project called Abraço. So Abraço, Associação Neuromat para Pessoas com Lesão de Plexo Brachial, the Neuromat Association for People Who Have a Brachial Plexus Action, who have a brachial plexus lesion. We, as Andrea said, differently from people with Parkinson's disease, the patients who have brachial plexus lesions still don't have a very organized structure. So we know that they have Facebook sites, but the idea is to help them forge or within Neuromat a structure which could serve as well as for support for these patients, but also to give them new information on the protocols, on the ideas, on the treatments. We are now on these directions. So this is the team who is going to present some results now. So I would like to invite José Vicente Martins to tell us a little bit more on the functional, on these functions on the brachial plexus lesion.
Hello, good morning, everyone. So first of all, I'd like to say that it's a big, great honor and pleasure to be here. Thank you, Professor Galvis, for the invitation, and thank you for organizing a so wonderful meeting. It's a great experience for us to share our knowledge with all of you. So I have a really tough task today because I have to talk a little bit more about a clinical aspect concerning brachial plexus injury. And I have just 10 minutes. When I usually explain to my students this topic at university, I usually spend more than 5 hours because I have to talk about clinical aspects, anatomy, many things. So, and I know that most of you here, you don't work with patients and you don't have real idea what's going on with this kind of patient. It's be a challenge for me. So I'm PT, I'm a physiotherapist. I teach at Federal University as Professor Claudio Vargas, and I'm the head of the physical therapy department of the Neurology Institute in Rio de Janeiro. So first, it's our team. Yeah, wait, you see more. I like this kind of presentation. So first of all, thanks Claudia. She is my advisor. We are really a close friend, and it's a great honor to belong to her team. So, and here is our hospital, where we work, Instituto de Urologia de Olinda Couto, in Rio de Janeiro. So first, you see that? Fantastic. So this is a new PowerPoint. So here is something about anatomy. We have here the brachial plexus. The brachial plexus is a network of nerves which comes from the spinal cord and it's going to the upper limb. And the brachial plexus supply motor innervation and also sensory innervation, of the shoulder, arm forearm, hand and fingers. So when we have a patient with this kind of lesion, here, we have this patient, it was after surgery, he underwent a surgery. You can see here the scar. We have this kind of problem. We have atrophy here. We can see the shoulder girdle. We have here a lot of loss of the muscle. Just to remind you, we have here this kind of divisions. We have roots, trunks, divisions, cord, and branch. To teach my students, I usually use the rule, remember to drink a cold beer. It's easier to memorize. So we have roots, and roots together will form trunk. We have here, for example, C5 and C6. Together, we have a upper trunk. When a patient have this kind of lesion, those patients cannot move the proximal part of the upper limb. The patient cannot move, for example, for flexion, shoulder flexion, abduction, and also elbow flexion. And we have the mid trunk, consisting C7 root, and we have the lower trunk, C8 and T1. When the lesion is here, the patient is not able to move the hand. So, like I said before, we have many causes of injury. We know that the most important cause of the injury is a motorcycle accident. When we have a high-speed accident, mainly with motorcycle, I'm going to show you later, we have patients with this kind of falling. Patients, usually they fall off the motorcycle and they have this kind of overstretch of this area. That means the head is going to one way and the shoulder to the opposite way. That means an overstretch of this area. And then we have blunt trauma, we have stab, unfortunately very common in Rio. We work in a public hospital. That means we have a lot of cases like that. Patients who have this kind of lesion with the knife. And we have a lot of gunshot. We have inflammatory process, we have compression, and we have neuropathies. But in our population, in our hospital, we have more this kind of patient. Patients who had some motorcycle accident. So we published this paper in 2011. That means we have been working with this kind of patient for many years. And we at this time, we had just 21 patients. Nowadays, we have more than 80. Yeah, Juliana is going to present this kind of data analysis. And at this time, when we published this article, we had 21 patients, 18 males and 3 females. and more than 70% of the lesion were caused by motorcycle accident. So when we talk about the lesion, we can have avulsion. That means with this lesion, you can see here the posterior part of the root, the anterior part of the root. With this lesion, the brachial plexus is not connected anymore with the spinal cord. And with this kind of lesion, the patient cannot have the spontaneous recovery. This kind of patient will have a surgery, neurosurgery. I'm going to show you later. So, or we can have just a stretch here, and here probably this kind of patient will have a spontaneous recovery. And we can also have here rupture. So when the lesion is before the ganglion here, we call preganglionic injury. And when we have after the ganglion, we have posterior. So like I said before, when we have a patient with this kind of injury, you can see here the patient fell down here, and we can see the head is going to one way and the shoulder to the other way. We can see this kind of lesion. This patient has a lesion of the upper trunk and also middle trunk. That means this patient, this kind of patient cannot move the proximal part of the arm and elbow. So, and then this is a classical patient. You can see here a lot of atrophy here. And this kind of patient can present a lot of impairments, such as weakness, loss of sensation, deep sensation and surface sensation, a lot of pain. Yeah, and one project of our group is to study how pain can affect the neuroplasticity and can affect the developed art of the recovery. And I'm going to show you one video, then you can see better. So, and then with this kind of lesion, we can see this little boy is holding here the branch, and then there is a over abduction. That means a lot of stress here in the middle and lower trunk, and then can cause this kind of lesion. So just to give you some before that, traumatic brachial plexus injury are a devastating injury that result in a partial or total denervation of muscle of the upper extremity. We have a lot of kinds of treatment, but concerning surgery, we have neurolysis. That means the doctors, they clean up the brachial plexus. They open and they check if there is a tumor or something, or fibrosis or something that can disturb the nerve. Or we have nerve grafting. That means they take one part of the sural nerve and they connect with the damaged nerve. Or we have a nerve transfer that I'm going to show you later. That means they can take one part of the healthy nerve, we call the donor nerve, and to connect to the recipient nerve. That means the affected nerve. So, and then restoration of elbow flexion is the primary goal in treating patients with severe brachial plexus injury. That means when we have a patient like this, the effort is try to restore the elbow flexion first, because from the literature, from the previous experience, we know that if the patient is able to bend his or her elbow, they can carry something, they can really improve their tasks during activity of daily living. So, and then this is a nerve transfer, just to give you some idea about that. And then I'm going to show you a video with a real patient. You can see here, when we have a upper trunk lesion, upper trunk injury, the doctors can remove or take away one part of the healthy nerve. We call this donor nerve. In this case, here is a ulnar nerve. Ulnar nerve supplies a lot of muscles here in the hand, but in this case, you can see that they can remove just a part we call fascicle of the nerve, and this fascicle can supplies wrist flexion. Yeah, and when the doctors remove, the patient will not have any deficit in this area. It's not a problem for that. And then they connect this part with the recipient nerve or the damaged nerve. What is the goal? The goal is when the patient try to bend the elbow, first this patient has to flex the wrist in order to be able to flex the elbow. Yeah? Because we'll see later that we have to change the brain map. Okay, there are many kinds of options. Another option is intercostal nerve. The doctors remove one part of this nerve, the fascicle, and connect to the musculocutaneous nerve. Musculocutaneous nerve supplies biceps, brachial muscle, and also coracobrachial muscle. Those muscles, biceps and brachial muscles, they work with this kind of movement, elbow flexion. And then, this is so interesting, Professor, because after this kind of surgery, we must ask the patient to breathe in order to flex his elbow. Because the brain map, yeah, the patient has to think about the movement, the original movement, the original donor nerve, in order to promote or in order to perform this elbow flexion. So, and then we can see here a movie, just quickly. This patient had a brachial plexus injury, upper part, but you can see he was able to get a really good result about elbow flexors. You can see here that his biceps is working very well. Yeah, and then the patient said to me, Vicente, okay, now I'm able to lift something. I'm able to lift more than 3 or 4 kilos with my hand, but I'm not able to drink a glass of water. What can I do with this kind of function? And then I asked him, okay, but with this kind of movement, are you able to eat? And then he said, no, unfortunately not. You can see here, if I try to bring the fork to my mouth, I have to put my head down like this. It's a kind of compensation. And then our question was, for what this kind of patient, they need this kind of surgery. And then he answered me, you know, I'm not able to do this, okay, but I'm able to carry something. And this patient, he works in a marketplace. And he usually carries a box with orange, with a lot of fruits, and for him was useful this kind of surgery. And also, after the surgery, he was able to drive. And he was able to write many things. So, yeah. Yeah, good question, because it was an upper lesion, we call upper trunk lesion. This kind of lesion, the patient will lose the shoulder function and the elbow function, but this kind of patient will preserve the hand function. The hand movement is normal, okay? It depends on the lesion, depends on the injury. So, and then idea is to check how many functions we can really assess after the surgery and for what. We have to tell our patients, you know, you're going to undergo this surgery and the results will be after the surgery. You will be able to, for example, to drive or to carry something or to use your upper limb for these kind of tasks. But we will not be able to do this kind of activities. That's so important for us. And We would like to study a little bit more about the brain map, what's going on with the brain, and also what's going on with the muscle synergy. This is so important for us. And then you can see here another patient. And this patient, he had a total brachial plexus injury. You can see in the beginning, he was not able to move his arm. He was not able to flex his shoulder. He was not able to abduct his shoulder. He was not able to bend his elbow. And also I asked him, okay, can you move your hand? And he said, no, I cannot. I cannot hold anything. I'm not able to do this. I'm just able to do little movement, but it's not useful for my daily living activities. And then you can see here, after rehabilitation, this patient could really move his arm. You can see here, he underwent a surgery. It was a surgery to restore this kind of function. Now he was able to move his hand, his fingers. But you can see that there are some compensations, of course, because when we compare the affected arm to the non-affected arm, we always find deficiencies. And then, concerning tasks, I asked him, okay, can you, just finish, look at that. Oops. What's going on here? Yeah. And then this patient was able to drink, to bring the glass to the mouth. Look at that. After, of course, 2 years rehabilitation. It's really tough to work with this kind of patient. I ask, he's able to comb his hair, and also he's able to carry something. You see, he's able to carry the book, the book, and also to walk and to carry something. Okay, yeah. Okay, I'm gonna finish now. So, thank you. On the time.
So, hello everyone. My name is Gabriel Freire. I am physical therapist and master student at Federal University of Rio de Janeiro. And I'm glad to be here today, briefly talking about some ideas of how to evaluate patients with brachial plexus injury. So as Professor Vicente told us, this kind of injury can cause several limitations in daily life activities to these patients, with different prognostic between the patients. Now, our objective is to develop a reliable evaluation protocol that permit us to understand the complex changes in motor control after brachial plexus injury, correlating the information of the following procedures: muscle strength evaluation, kinematic analysis, and functional scales. So, muscle strength is one of the most clinical parameters most used to evaluate patients' function nowadays. And with a handheld dynamometer, we can access the strength of major muscles involved in the shoulder and the arm function in different positions as described previously in the literature. And this kind of test is always realized in both arms. The major muscles are those responsible to the movements of shoulder flexion, shoulder abduction, shoulder internal and external rotation, and elbow flexion. In other kinematic is a high-tech and highly effective technique for extracting measures related to joint movement and displacements in the patient's center of mass. This is our lab in Rio de Janeiro, where we have 8 cameras of Vicon system that permit us to capture movements even in high speed. So, the preparation of the subject consists of system calibration and the positioning of 26 reflective markers on the patient's body surface. This is just an illustration. It's a kinematic model of a patient that has brachial plexus injury. So in the left block, we see the non-affect arm, and the left block, we see the affect arm trying to do the movement. And here we have some parameters we can extract from the analysis. So the angular displacement of each body segment during the execution of a movement, angular correlations between two or more body segments, and deviations on center of mass. So now our protocol consists of 6 tasks divided in 2 main groups. Functional tasks, those simulate the functional movements of a patient, and the structural tasks, just simple movements like flexion of elbow. And until now, we believe that the functional movements may have a better motor representation in cortex, probably resulting in better performance of the tested movements. And the functional tasks are bring a glass to the mouth, hold a waist-high cup, and hold a suitcase approximately 2 kilograms along the body. These are the structural tasks, shoulder flexion and shoulder abduction, and elbow flexion. So we have the disabilities of arm, shoulder, and hand outcome measure, aka the DASH. It's a 30-item self-report questionnaire designed to measure physical function and symptoms in patients with several kinds of disabilities in upper extremity that permit us to access any or all joints. And summarizing, chronologically, our experimental design had 2 steps. In the first one, we designed to evaluate the dynamometry, the strength parameters, and the DASH, the functional scale. And the second step, we designed to look for the kinematic analysis, in which we want to develop a sequence of movements that consists a modeling structure. And until now, we think the patient needs to begin the tests standing upright position in a start moment. Then a movie reproduction of a movement will be reproduced in an observation movement moment, and then the patient will execute the movement, will perform the movement. And now we wish to build a sequence of movements by taking into account an underlying structure. No?
Hello, everyone. My name is Fernanda. I'm a medical doctor and a physical therapist and a PhD student under the guidance of Professor Claudia Vargas. And I'm going to present for you today my thesis project, which is in very initial state, but aims to study cortical changes in brachial plexus injury patients with chronic pain. Okay. As Vicente has already said about the drastic consequences of this kind of injury, relating more to the movements and the functions of the patient. And I'm now going to focus a little more about the pain aspect of this patient. It's a very common complication. We have, according from different sources, about 65 to 70% of patients develop chronic pain. This is studied by Vanier. I think you can't read it, it's too small. But he found an even higher occurrence of pain. He found 95% of his patients, which means 57 out of 60 of his patients had chronic pain. Of those, 34 or 57% have had severe pain or recurrent acute pain crisis. In our lab, in our database, we have today 104 patients. Of those, we have 71 patients with pain, which is in accordance with the literature. The pain is of difficult treatment. It doesn't respond well to the classic drugs used. And even in opioids in high doses doesn't control the pain of these patients. As Claudia has already explained a little earlier, this kind of peripheral injuries generate brain plasticity, generate changes in brain plasticity. We've known since the 50s from the studies from Penfield that the motor cortex has a topographic representation. That is to say, large body segments are represented side by side on the cortex. And when we have a peripheral injury, this organization changes. So here we have a normal person and an empty person, and we can see that we have a difference in the representation of the injured part of the body. So when we have a limb empty, the representation area of this limb is smaller, and the representation of the stump, the remaining part, is bigger. The same kind of process also occurs in chronic pain. So Lotzi and his colleagues in 2001 studied with functional MRI, 14 patients with upper limb amputation and seven number controls, while they did lip movements, hand movements, and while they imagined the movement of the phantom limb in the case of the amputees, or the contralateral limb when with the novel subjects. So here we have the results when during the registration of the lip pursing, the lip movement, and we can see that patients who develop phantom limb pain had a spread of the area of the lip representation towards the hand area, which didn't occur with patients without who were amputees but didn't have phantom limb pain. And when the patients and the controls imagine the movement of the missing hand or the movement of the contralateral hand, we can see that patients which had pain, but not the patients who didn't have pain, there is also this spread of the area towards the face area of the cortex. Here we have a more didactic image by Butler and Mosley in 2013. What happens in the brain in the case of chronic pain and in phantom limb pain. The virtual body, the virtual image of the body on the cortex becomes smudged, it's less clear, and it probably involves, affects the movement of the patient. When you talk about, specifically about brachial plexus injury, we have some studies that try to investigate how these changes occur. But these studies are usually focused on specific surgeries, and they are not longitudinal. They are done months after the surgery and evaluate only that moment. We don't have a longitudinal study yet. and we don't have yet a model on how to predict how these changes are going to occur when you have this kind of injury. So the goal of my study is to investigate the pain influence of cortical representations in brachial plexus injury patients using transcranial magnetic stimulation. This technique uses a coil over the scalp of the subject, which generates a magnetic pulse that generates an electric current that influences the neurons and the stability of the cortical spinal tract. We can measure this excitability peripherally through electromyography. So we first chose to work with three muscles, the biceps brachii to study the superior trunk, the extensor carpi radialis to study superior and middle trunks, and the abductor digit minimi to study the inferior trunk. So these are our goal focus muscles. So we then aim to assess cortical plasticity on this muscle groups of interest evaluating the changes in resting motor threshold and in MAP amplitudes. So the first step for this is to find the hot spot, which is the spot on the scalp of the subject where we can achieve a large amplitude with greater easiness. We then find the resting motor threshold, which is the minimum intensity we can apply on the pulse and register an activity of 50 microvolts in 5 out of 10 pulses applied. We then increase the intensity. We then increase the intensity of the stimulus to generate these recruitment curves, and as we change spots on the scalp, we can do the cortical mapping of the studied muscles. We are going to work with three groups of subjects: a group of patients with pain, another group of patients without pain, and of course, healthy volunteers. We are going to work with any degree, type, or time since the trauma, and both genders and ages between 18 and 40. Healthy volunteers without any nervous system or motor system disorders. We're going to exclude from our work patients with cranioencephalic trauma, which is very common associated with the automobilistic trauma. Any cognitive deficits, any history of central nervous system or peripheral nervous system diseases, or any history of chronic pain before the injury. We are going to do, aside from the TMS, and a subjective evaluation for the identification of the type of injury through the use of complementary exams. We are going to do also an objective evaluation using a little of what we said before about the strength, sensibility, and range of movement. And a specific evaluation about pain using body map pain, intensity scales, the brief pain inventory, the DN4, which is a questionnaire for neuropathic pain, the McGill, which is a questionnaire that assesses different dimensions of pain. And then we expect to understand a little more about this very complex type of patients that we work with, because we have the influence over the brain plasticity caused by the peripheral injury, and we have the same kind of influence caused by chronic pain. And we hope to understand a little better how these two factors work on our patients. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Juliana Maia. I'm physical therapy too. And I will talk about the spirits of multidisciplinary databasing in traumatic brachial plexor injury. I work in the same lab of the group in Rio de Janeiro. We work with a NES, Neuroscience Experiment System. Okay, so sorry, it's, yes. I will try to read, I'm a little bit nervous. In 2014, CEPID Neuromat, software development team, released the first version to NES. NES is an open source tool able to manage it and a wider range of data related by healthcare and research experience we can use. In November, we start in our lab, in our hospital, we start to use NAS to integrate the data we collect to our patients. And now, 2 years, NAS is continuous updating by new versions to according our necessity. Neuroscience Experiment System, NAS, is a free open source software to manage clinical and experimental data. It stores detailed descriptions of the experimental protocols and their raw data and metadata. We can integrate and centralize repository data from research, labs, group, and other projects. Manage different types of data, clinical, electrophysiological surveys, like data from the works present here. And now NAS is available in this site. The notorious, the NAS is good for us because they can union the different types of works and different types of professionals. Like in our lab, we have physical therapists, neuroscientists, physicians. Like Neuromat, we have computer science, mathematicians, physicians. And we wait, make NAS so singular and interesting to us, and like we saw in the other data banks. Okay. The objectives to NAS, it's a put in common ground different types of data, like clinical, functional, electrophysiological, and experimental data. It offers the possibility to have data from different sources, which can be analyzed and create predictive models. The next, please. The second objectives include storage, manage, and make data available. Now, NAS is only used in our lab, but he is disponible. It's available to other group with other projects, different projects. It's just a change. Just see we have different kinds of data to improve the experience with the clinical with the patient, please. The interface to NAS, the functionalities we had, it's very easy to use. We can put in the programs what we really need. So now we have it's difficult to read. We have various blocks to patients, all of our questionnaires, set up for the experiments of the group. It's everything is put in the NAS. Here's an example for we put in the history clinical of the patients, demographic the information like where they live and everything. Can pass. Sorry, is can to read, but here we have all of the questionnaires. Like here we have assessment by pain. We have assessment by functional movement. We have assessment we create and assessment we have a standard to the to this kind of injuries. Now we have a 15 sometime kinds of questionnaires. In this part, we have the setup to the experiment. Here is the experiment to EAG. Malu will talk about tomorrow, and we have put everything to the experiments will be covered. Okay, here we have the part we can export the information to put in the NAS. Sorry. And we can export a little bit data from a specific experiment, or we have export a big data to with the information of all of the questionnaire, for example, all little things is specific. And now, our challenge is how to long-term database and feeding is something we have to ask and trocar and change with Amparo, for example. They have a lot of information by the Parkinson patients, and we have to feed this database we have today. We're trying to customization the interface is very is a little bit hard because we have the clinical necessities to put this information to do the NAS useful for us, clinical. And we have to talk with the scientists, the computadores. To Kelly, for example, we have to talk and take a, I'm sorry. Chegar a um denominador comum. Common denominator, thanks. Can pass. Now the current numbers we have, like Fernanda said, we have 104 patients, 71 patients have pain. So this motorcycle accident is the most impact we have. 50 questionnaires, and now in NAS we have two experiments described. Yes, for the documentary. Thank you.
Okay, good afternoon to everybody. I want to thank Professor Antonio for inviting me to be here, and also to NeuroMag group. My name is Noslen Hernandez. Antonio and NeuroMag and the group of NeuroMag. My name is Noslen Hernandez, and I'm going to briefly present to you a project we recently submitted to FAPERT for a postdoctoral research. So the idea is to present some of the idea we are planning to work into and not results. There is a recent results from Duarte, Freeman, Galvez, Ost, and Claudia in which it is addressed the hypothesis that the brain is a statistician. And in this work, it is introduced a new kind of stochastic process named stochastic process driven by context tree model. And with this definition, the authors allowed to support the hypothesis that the brain is doing statistic. Briefly, the subject is simulated with some random stimulus, and on each stimuli, it is recording an EEG data. This sequence of stimuli are structured, and it is used context tree model to generate these random sequences. In this work, it is introduced a new statistical model selection procedure for functional data, and with this new model selection procedure, these EEG data are processed, and they effectively identify the structure, the context tree model that generate the source. So the question we can face is, can such finding be corroborated in behavioral response? That means when the subject is exposed to some sequence of a stimulus, but now it is asked to the subject to execute some movement. For example, in the rehabilitation of patients or in the goalkeeper game developed by Neuromath, in the case when, of course, the goalkeeper is executing the movement. Well, briefly, in the theoretical framework to carry out this kind of experiment, we will have an alphabet to which the stimuli will take place. We will have a sequence of stimulus generated according to some regular statistical pattern, and this sequence will be what we will call an structured Markov chain. And this is no more than a random change in which the probability of observing a given unit is given, is conditioned to the observed past. And this space of relevant past is structured according to some partition. And this probability will be indexed by the group to which the past belong to in the partition. We will have, as in the work of the people of Neuromath, a sequence of response, and to model the relation between the sequence of stimuli and the response, we will define stochastic process driven by structured Markov chain. And this is here, this X variable is going to be a structured Markov chain just defined, and the distribution of the response variable will be conditioned also to this structure of classes given in the space of past. The stochastic process driven by context tree model is an outstanding example of what we have tried to briefly define here, and we've seen that for the beginning of the experiments we are going to use this structure to define the sequence of a stimulus, and there are some works I need to study that Professor Garber suggests to me, in which some related idea with this kind of process have been already introduced. there is some challenge problems that we have to face in the designing of this experiment with movement. One of them is the design of suitable experiment to evaluate the evidence about learning statistical regularity. We need to carefully specify the alphabet in which our stimulus will take values. We need to specify the response variable. For the case of movement, there are going to be a great variability in the space in which this variable will take value. For example, very briefly, in the goalkeeper game, in which the alphabet can be considered the duration in which the ball is jumped, we will observe some raw data, maybe some curve of spatial position, or maybe some video gathered for some sensor cameras. And from this raw data, we can define, depending on what we are interested in a study, the space for this response variable. It can be as simple as just the duration in which the goalkeeper is going to jump, or it can be a functional data representing the trajectory of that movement, or it can be not only when the goalkeeper is going to jump, but if it is executing the movement good or bad, and many other examples can appear. Also, we have to define the kind of a statistical pattern from the stimulus sequence. If we use, for example, the context tree model, we know that the context in this kind of model define a partition of the space, and that the probability of observing a forthcoming unit is given by the context associated to the observed past. But this is not the there exists another partition in this space of past, and it's related to the transition probability. So two past will belong to the same classes if they generate the same transition probabilities for the forthcoming unit. And the subject might adopt a form of representation in the process of learning that does not necessarily have to be involved with the context tree model. So we found interesting to put some constraints in the transition probability, and for example, we can oblige them to be different, and in this way, these two partitions would be the same. And if the subject is learning the statistical structure of the sequence of stimuli, then we can assure that if he identified the context, then we can assure that if the subject is learning this structure of classes of probability, then it must be identified the context in the model. Also, another question, for example, how to quantify and control the complexity of the statistical pattern, because the learning task will obviously depend on it, how easy is being the learning task of how difficult. Another challenging problem is how to extract from our raw data the relevant information for the response variable in the model. For example, in a motion capture system, as some other colleagues has shown, we will have to deal with some pattern recognition techniques and machine learning, more specifically in the area of computer vision. Maybe we have to do some gesture recognition, and more importantly than recognizing what gesture the subject is doing, to obtain a good representation of that gesture. And depending on the level of detail the software that bring with this kind of system has, maybe we have to take care about tracking algorithms and those kind of things. And the last problem is related to inference. For the case when the response variable is a functional data, there is a consistent model selection procedure already introduced in the work of this college. This model selection procedure have a two-sample hypothesis testing step for functional data and use a random projection method of Berto Cuesta, Freeman, and Ransfor. And we plan to test another recently hypothesis test introduced for functional data that maybe can improve the power of this statistical test. Both of these tests are non-parametric, so we think that maybe can be interesting not only to know if the distribution are different or not, but to look where are those differences, maybe doing some functional tests on particular parameter of those distribution, like the means. And as another line of research that it's related with this of analyzing movement, maybe there appear some biomedical questions like the detection of deviation from normality in movement or the longitudinal study of patients under training. And for that, we plan to going into some modern functional data analysis tools like functional cluster analysis, dissimilarity measure between functional population, and so on, in order to analyze the functional data that we are going to obtain from the trajectory of the movement. So thank you.